Before this world was, and he said, thine they were, and thou gavest them unto me, and I've kept them through thy name, and I've lost none of them save the son of perdition. And he said, Father, I pray for these. I pray not that you should take them out of the world, but keep them through thy name. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And he said, sanctify them through thy truth. And then he said, thy word is truth. Hallelujah. Glory to God. But thank God for another breed, another group that he mentioned. He said, I pray not for these alone, but I pray for another group. I pray for another people that's going to come into this thing and believe on my name. He said, even keep them and even glorify them. Glory to God. I am them and thou in me.
Yes.
Come on now. That they may be one in us.
Yes.
Glory to God. And at that very moment, Jesus the Christ became Jesus the high priest, the intercessor. That's the real Lord's Prayer. Matthew 6 is the disciples' prayer, but Matthew 17 is what the Lord prayed. He didn't pray that in Matthew 6. He told us to pray that, but he didn't pray it when he got ready to pray. He prayed, Father, the hour has come. Glory to God for me to be glorified. And he entered into the office of the great high priest of this whole earth. And everything he did from there out, he done it as an intercessor. Come on now. He didn't have no sin to die for. He didn't have nothing in him. He said, the prince of this world cometh and ain't got nothing in me. Everything he did from that moment on, he did it as an intercessor. He did it in our stead. He did it as us. Even the appearing in the presence of God on behalf of forgiven sin, he said he appeared in the presence of God in the book of Hebrews as us. Come on now. As us. And Hebrews 6 says that we've got a forerunner that has entered into that within the veil. And the forerunner means there's a bunch more coming. On the scene, that's going to do the same thing he did. They're going to put their foot on the head of every enemy. And the last enemy is death.
Amen.
Amen. And that to be carnally minded is death. So the day that we finally recognize that the mind of Christ is enough and we don't have to depend on mortality for life. Come on now. But this mortal shall put on immortal, and this corruption shall put on incorruption, and then shall be brought to pass the saying, it is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O grave, where is your victory? Amen. The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law.
Amen.
But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Paul said, we see not yet all things put under his feet. But in the next line he said, but we do see Jesus, who has entered in and sat down. Hallelujah. And so he is the testimony tonight. Glory to God, he's the testimony. He's the pattern son. Glory to God.
Amen.
It behooved him to become like his brethren. Why? So his brethren would find out that they were just like him. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thanks be to God for his unspeakable gift tonight. The gift of his love, his mercy,
hallelujah,
his endeavor to come down into this mess,
yes,
and say, glory to God, you all ain't, the only trouble with you all is you're lost. You don't know who you are. Amen. I've come to tell you who you are. That's basically what he was doing. He come to tell the real man who he was. He come to make an announcement. And every announcement he made brought controversy. Every announcement he made in this earth stirred up every religious spirit. Did it not? Whether it was on the street or in the synagogue, any time he made an announcement, a redemptive announcement, it was a total stir among the people. Excuse me while I get the cover off my microphone. I knocked it off without action. Amen. But aren't you glad you're in the house of the Lord tonight? Hallelujah, I am. Praise God. I got them boys over there working. And I don't mind telling you, I'd rather be up here on this air conditioning vent than over there, sweating. Amen. But the Lord's good. Praise the Lord. And he's wonderful. And we just thank him tonight for you being here. I'll have to get that on later. But anyway, we just want to speak blessings over everybody. I know there's a lot can't be here tonight. They want to be, but they need the prayers of the saints to lift them up. Amen. And brother, I tell you what, good things happening this week. Old brother Calvin went in yesterday, and they went to postpone his surgery because the last doctor he seen said he had blockage, and he went in and got a cath, heart cath yesterday. And bless God, there wasn't no blockage. Amen. It was gone. Hallelujah. Wasn't nothing there. Amen. So, good things. I could tell you about a couple of more, but right now I've lost thought of them. I had a couple of good ones I was going to tell you, and now I'll remember them later. But anyway, we want to pray for Sue's got her brother-in-law's nephew is is in the hospital and he's had four heart attacks and he needs a touch of God in his life tonight. Amen. And we're believing God to touch him. Yes, we are. And standing on the faith ground for him tonight. And also, I'm sure everybody knows by now, but brother, you know, Brother Ken Hill passed away suddenly on Monday. And so we want to keep holding him up. All Sister Winnie's wife and all of his children, they have a big family, and they're going to have a memorial service this Saturday at 1 o'clock at a church in Fort Myers. So pray for everybody to be strengthened and for them to get through what they have to get through. Praise the Lord. And just make them strong and lift them up and encourage them in their spirit. Amen. And how many know the Lord will move for that family? He'll move for her. He'll move for them kids. And somehow they will feel the ministry of the Holy Spirit through all this. God will be faithful to lift them up. Amen. And so what our job to do is when people going through that, we become their strength. We lift them up. Amen. We pronounce blessings over their life. Amen. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Also keep Sister Merlene in your prayers and thoughts, and believe God to just raise her up completely. She needs the touch of the Lord tonight, and we're believing God to do so. Amen. And all other people that may need it, just believe in God. I'm speaking. I don't really feel like I need to pray right now. I'm just speaking the word of the Lord to every one of them and believing God for a total turnaround in their life. Hallelujah. Boy, I feel a turnaround tonight. I feel the anointing of God in here tonight. Hallelujah. We're going to get ready to give to the Lord. If you will, get your gifts and offerings ready to bring, and we bless you in the name of the Lord as you bring them. Amen.
Used to finding that one may take you a minute.
Glory to God. Oh, don't you love Jesus? Oh, glory to God. How many sense has it changed in the atmosphere? How many can tell in the spirit God's up to something? How many can tell that God's preparing us to receive something of a higher order? And how many know when the cloud moves, you don't just sit there and watch it move all from you. You get up and you leave the place where you are. And you start following that cloud. Yeah. Praise the Lord. When in Moses' day, they followed the cloud. In Joshua's day, they followed the ark. Amen. And if you got up in Moses' day, you might be left behind. You may, the Lord wouldn't even let them drive their stakes all the way into the ground. When they tied their tent down, He wouldn't let them drive them in permanent position. Everything they did was temporal. Sister Marty was teaching on that the other night. That in 2 Corinthians 3, it said that that glory was a fading glory. It was a temporary glory. It was a glory passing away, yet it was still glorious. And yet here we are in the new covenant and under the new order and under a new priesthood. We're going to be relate some to that for a few moments now. Under a new priesthood, and this priesthood is being crowned right now in this hour. God is crowning that new priesthood with His glory. Hallelujah. In Solomon's hour, when the glory filled the temple, the old priesthood couldn't even stand to minister. Come on now. Because a new glory had come in. And the old ministry didn't know what to do with that new glory. They couldn't even operate. They couldn't even minister. The Bible says when Moses and Aaron completed the tabernacle, Moses carried Aaron and his two sons in, anointed them on their right ear and their right thumb and their right big toe. And that was after He poured it on their head. And it got all over their garments. Glory to God. And then the Lord commanded Moses, said, go through this whole tabernacle and sprinkle everything in here with the blood. Glory to God. That was prophetic of the coming new covenant. Amen. And then He went all the way out to the congregation, and then He sprinkled blood. Come on the congregation. What was He doing? He was transitioning them on into a greater glory. And the Bible said when Moses and Aaron got ready to go in that tabernacle and minister, they could not even enter into the tabernacle because the glory had filled the temple from top to bottom. Glory to God. When the glory fills this temple, you won't be no room for no other man to operate in your life. It'll just be the King. Glory to God. Isaiah said, my eyes have seen the King of glory. And when did his eyes see it? When Uzziah died. And what does that mean? The old flesh. The old carnal. Because Uzziah tried to enter into the priesthood. Come on now. And he wasn't called of God for priesthood. He was a king, but he wasn't a priest. And he went into the holy place, not the holy of holies, but the holy place, and tried to offer incense. Remember that? On the altar. And the priest came in there and said, don't touch that altar. You don't have any rights here. But he reached out to touch it anyway and was smote with leprosy in his forehead. That's how he died. So when you read Isaiah say in the year Uzziah died, it means more than just a good old man dying. Hallelujah. It means he tried to rule and reign with that old natural mind inside of the priesthood. And God said he smote him in the forehead. Come on now. With leprosy. And the priest that was standing by him also had something on his forehead. He had on the front of his forehead holding the son to the Lord. But Uzziah, the natural, carnal, my God, man who tries to set himself up to be king when he is nothing more than a defeated foe. Glory to God. Lord, help us. There's a new sheriff in town. There's a new leader. There's a new way of doing things. And you cannot do them by the old covenant anymore. The Bible said you are cursed with a curse. Who's cursed with a curse? Them people that try to operate under that old order system that's already dead and already gone. They all are worried about the natural temple. Into natural temple. You're the temple of the Holy Ghost. Can you say amen? They're worried about some man coming up out of the Middle East. I don't care whether he come up the Middle East or the Middle West. Come on now. That man of sin, that man of perdition, is that natural man of yours that clings to death.
Amen.
And speaks mixture.
That's right. Amen.
And tries to set himself up as God in your temple.
Yes, he is.
Come on. And there ain't but two things will get rid of it. That's the spirit of the Lord's mouth and the brightness of his coming.
Amen.
That means the spirit of his mouth means the living word. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God.
Amen.
The brightness of his coming means the more revelation you get of him. The brighter he gets in your life, the more he extinguishes the light. Amen, because it ain't real light. The moon ain't got no light of her own. It's a reflection. Can you say amen? But when he saw that woman in Revelation 12, Lord, my heart's so full tonight. I've meditated on so many things today. You just gonna get a potluck dinner tonight. Amen. I said the woman in Revelation 12 said the moon was under her, glory to God, and said she was clothed with her sun and she had 12 stars. Come on now. On her head. Hallelujah. Glory. I'm trying to show you when God gets to moving, we sing it, you got to move. You got to be ready. You can't just sit around and pray for these things to happen. Then when God starts doing it, you don't do anything about it. If that's the case, you know better than the religious down the road. Hallelujah. If the Lord gets to moving, starts opening up ways and doors and opportunities and visions and revelations and whatever, my God, you can't take a side seat and keep on a muttering, I wish the Lord would do something. I wish he'd move. I want you to know he's doing something. Right now, he's blowing. He's blowing. Now, I'll tell you something. When Marty was preaching the other Wednesday, I don't always come down here and sit on the ground. I usually just sit on the platform. I kind of like them chairs. They're comfortable. And I don't stay up there for no religious purpose. I just like my seat. But anyway, she's so short till I couldn't see her from the pulpit. And so I don't like to not see who's talking. So I came down and sat down on the front row. And two times while she was preaching, I heard a wind blow through that direction so twice, and I thought somebody had opened the window. Now that's the truth, it was storming outside. But I mean, I felt it and I heard it. It almost sounded like the suction of a fast train when it goes by. That's how strong it was. And I knew then the Lord was letting me know there was a shifting. There was a movement going to take place. And then Sunday, my God, I tell you, I felt it strong all day. And then even when I went home to lay down after the service for a little bit before coming back that night, I could feel it rumbling in my spirit feels turning. You ever get that way? You ever get like you almost want to grab your breath because something's excited your spirit so much? Whoa, that Holy Ghost anticipation. Like when you're happy to see somebody and you almost get all, butterfly inside, get all, amen. I used to get that way when I went to see my wife, you know, when we was dating. If I knew she was coming, I'd get all jittery. I'd get ready to see her. Amen. I might get that way now. We just ain't never apart to find out, but I might still do it. I'd hope I would. Amen. But anyway, you know how you are when you're trying to get somewhere you really want to be. My God, and you want to get there so bad, by the time you get about 40 or 50 miles from that place, you start getting a little feeling on the inside. And that's the kind of feeling I've had in my spirit in the Lord, like I'm about to get somewhere where, oh, hallelujah, like I'm about to get somewhere that I really wanted to be, hallelujah. And I feel like we're in the Lord's chariot tonight, hallelujah, and he's transporting us. And that's the reason I wanted to read these words to you in Zechariah 6. He said, I turned and lifted up my eyes and looked, and behold, there came four chariots out from between two mountains. Woo! Glory to God. I could shout off that one line tonight. I holla, oh, gee. Woo! He said, I looked and seen four chariots. I don't have to tell you the number four is the number of creation. There's four living creatures before the throne. Can you say amen? The fourth day is when he set things in an earthly order. And there became time and sun and things of that nature happened on the fourth day. First 3 days, there was light, but there wasn't no sun. S-U-N. The Lamb was the light. Can you say amen?
Amen.
But notice that this has got too much revelation not to break this verse out, you know, down to you a little bit. Notice first thing he did, he said, I turned.
Right.
And you don't never see nothing in the Lord until you turn.
Yeah.
That wheel's got to turn in you.
Yeah.
John in Revelation 1 said, I turned to see the voices spake with me, and then he said, and be it turned. Glory to God. He turned by faith, and then the Lord took hold.
Hallelujah.
And turned him in the spirit.
Amen.
And so he could see into another dimension. Oh, glory to God. I turned, you see. What's that scripture? 2 Corinthians 3, isn't it? Nevertheless, when it turneth unto the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. And then that next verse said, we all with open face, my God, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into that same image from glory unto glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. We used to sing, of course, a lot more often than we do now. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. And after he turned, he said, I lifted up mine eyes. Now, we know the first recollection we have of such a thing as a lifting up of the eyes is when the Lord called Abraham out of his tent and said, Abraham, he had done told him to look around him and see the sands by the seashore. Everybody say natural sea. But that night, everybody say at night, that's always when God starts something new. The evening and then the morning was the first day. When did the cry for the bridegroom happen? At midnight. When did the four leprous men get up and march in victory? In the twilight. Come on now. When does the watchman get on the wall? In the nighttime. Come on now. And he said, I've set watchmen on your wall that won't hold their peace day or what? Night. And so the Lord called Abraham out at night and said, now you've looked at the sand, lift up your eyes now. And when you lift them up, he said, look into the heavens and see if you can count the stars. For he said, I want to talk to you now about another seed. Everybody say another seed. There's another kind of seed. It ain't got nothing to do with the Ur of the Chaldees or the natural land of Canaan. But it's a spiritual people that's going to come forth. My God, the Lord said to Job, where were you when the sons of God sang together, or the morning stars sang together, and the sons of God shouted for joy. They that be wise shall shine as the firmament. Hallelujah. Them wasn't just stars of vapor and gas and things of that nature. He was looking at people, glory to God, people that were chosen in God from the foundation of the world. Hallelujah. One time the Lord God was talking about to Job, and he talked about Pleiades and different ones of the stars. What did he mean? He was referring to that supernatural seed, that people that's been chosen for an eternity, who had not yet come into the earthen realm. I wonder tonight if Job looked up that night when the Lord gave him that revelation and saw you. I wonder if one of them stars he seen was me shining, glory to God, shining in the firmament, in the mind of God, in the very original plan of creation. Before Proverbs 8 said, when they wasn't even a seed, and when, oh, glory to God. Can you say praise the Lord? Let's turn over, hold your finger there in Zechariah. We'll just have us a Bible teaching tonight. Proverbs chapter 8. Them's good. That's good reading, folks. That'll tell you right where you were, where you come from. All this mess. People don't believe this. If they did, they'd quit believing in them generation curses. And they'd quit thinking they had some kind of bloodline that flowed with disease. Come on now. And infirmity. I don't care if every brother and sister you have heart disease. That don't mean you do. When you come into the kingdom of God, every root is cut off of you except the righteous branch. Amen. Every root. And he says, glory to God. Let me get on down to the bottom, because you ain't got time to read all of that. Let's start in, Lord help. It's all too good. Verse 22. The Lord possessed me in the beginning of his ways, before his works of old. Are you listening to that? The Lord possessed me. I was his. Before he ever worked a work. Before he ever uttered his voice. Before he ever had anything of substance called earth. Or heaven, for that matter. Come on now. I was a prophetic word in him. You want to know why I believe in prophecy? Because I believe that's what I was before I got here. I was a prophetic word. He sent me forth out of his mouth like an arrow. And I don't care what I've had to walk through, go through, or look at, or whatever. I believe he hit the bullseye when he sent it. Come on. I can't help what my interpretation of it was. I must believe that he does all things right. And he does all things good. And he does all things well. Regardless of how I've distorted it with my thinking, God's way is the good life. The high life. Can you say praise the Lord? He said he possessed me before his works of old. I was set up from everlasting, from the beginning or the earth ever was, when there were no depths. I was brought forth when there were no fountains abounding with water. When before the mountain settled, or before the hills was I brought forth. While as yet he had not made the earth, nor the field, nor the highest part of the dust of the world. Come on now, that's talking about Adam, ain't it? Huh? Who's the highest part of the dust? And he said, Lord, when he prepared the heavens, I was there. When he set a compass on the face of the depth, when he established the clouds above, when he strengthened the fountain of the deep, when he gave to the sea his decree that the waters should not pass his commandment, and he appointed the foundation of the earth, I was by him as one brought up with him. Come on now. And I really liked him, and I was daily his delight. You know why I shout and run and holler and speak in tongues and shake when I feel the anointing of God? Because it brings back memories.
Amen.
Of some time in eternity.
Yes, sir.
Before I ever got in this body.
That's right.
When I sat with him in the heavens.
Yes, amen.
When I spoke with him of supernatural things. And he was daily my delight.
Yes.
My God. I was rejoicing always before him. Rejoicing in the habitable part of his earth. And my delights were with the sons of men.
Yes, amen.
My God, what a scripture.
Yes.
So he lifted up his eyes. Go back now to the ridge. He lifted up his eyes and seen four chariots. Four chariots. That involves us.
Yes.
Because it's creation. And these chariots come out from between two mountains. There's a lot the Bible has to say about mountains. The probably the highest spoken of two mountains would be Mount Sinai and Mount Zion. Mount Sinai is the old law. Hebrews 12, it runs both of them and read it all the way through the whole chapter. Tells us we've not come anymore to that mountain. If we've not come to it, then we've come from it. I've left it. I left it behind. Amen. And I've come to the firstborn church of the living God, whose names are written in heaven, to the innumerable company of angels, to the spirits of just men made perfect. Somebody say praise the Lord. My God. Hallelujah. And these chariots come out from between these two mountains. And listen carefully. They were mountains of brass. So right away, if the mountains ain't real mountains, then it ain't just talking about chariots such as horse chariots. There's a meaning behind it.
Yeah.
There's something to do with it. And I should stop here and say that first and foremost, anybody ought to know to read chariot, it means somebody's getting ready to move from one place to another.
Yeah.
And that somebody is you.
Yeah.
Glory. Secondly, you ought to know chariots speak of wealth. Poor people didn't have chariots. They went on foot. Most of the time, a chariot only carried prominent people, like Naaman the leper, who was a general in the king's army. And then in the Songs of Solomon, it said, I've compared thee, O my love, to a company of Pharaoh's horses. You got to get into spirit to read the Bible, folks. You don't, you'll think you're a horse eating grass by the side of the road. But how many of you know what a horse, Pharaoh's horse, was for? It was to bring the king into view. And he was saying to her, you're going to make me look good when we go. And did not the bride in the Songs of Solomon get in the chariot with Solomon? Come on now. When it got time for her to be revealed, when he revealed his bride, how many of you believe the Lord Jesus right now is revealing his bride in this earth? How many of you know Ephesians 5 says that he might sanctify it by the washing of the water of the word, that he may present it unto himself a glorious church, not having spot, blemish, wrinkle, or any such thing? How many believe that the Lord will have a presentation of a bride in this earth who is not sick or feeble or broke or messed up or, my God, disdained or depressed or oppressed or anything else or tainted by false doctrine? Glory be to God. She'll be a pure meaning. She won't have none of man in her. She'll be totally, glory to God, transformed by the real word of God. She'll have all power. in heaven and in earth on display. He's his bride. He teaches us in the Bible how he does brides. First of all, he decks them. He bathes them. He anoints them. He lets them lie for 6 months in oil and 6 months in sweet smelling spices. And then the Bible says it decked the bride, hung chains of gold about her neck, and they esteem wealth upon her. Amen. Which speaks of the lavish work and move of the Holy Ghost in this hour. She won't be a dead church. She won't be dried up or dried out. She'll be youthful. She'll be young. She'll be swift. She'll be fast. She'll run like roes and deer on top of the mountain. She'll have vitality and youth. Glory to God. And she'll have the wealth and kingdom of the King. And Solomon brought her out how? On his chariot. Glory to God. Chariots bring out prominent people. And the Holy Ghost said to me when I was reading through some of this after a little time spent in prayer today, he said, I'm getting ready to raise up prominent people in the kingdom. Not just in evangelical, fundamental, and Pentecostal platforms, but kingdom. Some of them old suckers everybody's run from, they're getting ready to run to. Because the chariot of the Lord. And now we're going to read further and find out these ain't even chariots in literal chariots. Read on now. He said the first chariot was red horses, the second chariot black horse, the third chariot white horse, the fourth chariot gristled and bay horses. Amen. Now that ain't got nothing to do with apocalypse. Just read on. Then I answered and said unto the angel that talked with me, what are these, my Lord? And the angel answered and said unto me, these are the four spirits of the heaven. Now, if you got a reference Bible, I don't have. I just got an old Cambridge Bible. But if you have a reference Bible, most reference Bible will tell you that the literal interpretation of four spirits there means four winds. Oh my. Four winds of the heaven. Now we go over in Revelation and find one angel holding all four winds. And he's got power to loose them in every direction. Can you say amen? We know that when Isaiah spoke of the prophetic restoration of this end time we're in right now, he said, and I'll say to the north to give up, and I'll say to the south to give up, and I'll say to the east to give up, and I'll say to the west to give up. Amen? And so when he said four winds blowing, he's talking about God's getting ready to send power from every direction. From every direction. The wind of God. Every direction has a purpose. Yes. The north wind is the wind that cleanses us on the inside. It does a work in us. The south wind is a cool, refreshing wind. Brings in the springtime with it. Oh, glory to God. It's a sign winter's over. Well, why blow in the north wind? Because all them dead leaves and all them dead twigs and all them dead branches. You know, you go out in your yard and look up at a 25-foot in the end of a 25-foot up in the top of a tree, see a dead limb hanging there. You don't go rent a bucket and reach up there and pull that limb down if it's already broke off. Let it lay there. The north wind. It'll come cleanse that tree. Will it not? It'll blow that thing down. It'll cleanse it. Every year, them trees get ugly. And every year, the north wind, come on now, blows through here and thoroughly cleans out them trees. And every spring, the wind changes feeling. Oh, glory. And changes direction. Come on now. And instead of a wind that's cutting and shivering, it becomes a pleasant feel. And it blows in the odors of spring. Yes. Amen. Amen. And then you got a west wind. wind, controlling the waters, controlling the seasons and the rains. But then you got an east wind. That's the wind of change. It brings in the new day. It blows in the newness. Oh my God. And he said that he said, these are the four winds or spirits of the heaven which go forth from standing before the Lord of all the earth. Amen. And the black horses which are therein go forth in the north. Come down. Don't you know if them prophecy preachers was preaching this, every time they read North Country, they think it's Russia. But I want you to know I'm not preaching about Russia tonight. I'm talking about the work of the Spirit. I'm talking about the work of the Lord. I've been getting blessed by the word tonight. Glory to God. And so he said that the black horse go into the north and the white go after them. Did you hear that? The black go in, but the white go after them. Amen. And what does it say? And the grizzled go toward the south, and the bay went forth the salt to go, that they might walk to and fro through the earth. And he said, get you hence, walk to and fro through the earth. So they walked. Come on now. Yeah. They walked. What walked? That wind of God. That Spirit of God. The eyes of the Lord are running to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong in behalf of him. Oh God is very active on this earth right now. Let me get you illuminated to something. Jesus Christ never left this earth. No, he did not. His glory to God, his flesh went back to dust. Come on. But his body, I didn't say his flesh, I said his body was glorified. Come on. But his body, after being glorified, he was ascended. But his spirit, glory to God, never left this planet. It inhabited the saints of God. And ever since it's been a Pentecost. Are you listening to me? The Holy Ghost is a resurrected spirit of Jesus. And he's always been here. And he's roamed this earth and this earth. And you say amen. And they said, read on with me a little bit more. They walked to and fro through the earth, and then cried he upon me and said, behold, these that go toward the north country have quieted my spirit. Are you listening to it? Have quieted my spirit in the north country. My God. If you thank God tonight, the Lord's able to quiet. He's able to quieten down some things. He's able to glory to God. And then he said, and the word of the Lord, this is where I want to read on down about verse 12. The word of the Lord said unto me, take of them of the captivity, even of Heldai, of Tobijah, and Jedidiah, which are come from Babylon, and come thou the same day and go into the house of Josiah the son of Zephaniah. Now everybody noticed there that when the wind got to blowing, something got happening real fast. Yeah. The Lord said, go this very day. Yeah. Don't hold off on this. Yeah. My God, I'm so tired of everybody thinking it takes 6 weeks and 6 months and 2 years to get it. I believe I can have it tonight if I just reach into that dimension of God. Hallelujah! And the Lord said to them, get in there now. Go this very day. Why? Because the wind's blowing. The Spirit's moving. God's talking. Do something. Respond to it. Glory. David said, Lord, you want me to go up like I did before? He said, no, I want you to fetch a compass around them and let it be when you hear the sound of the going in the tops of the mulberry trees. Can you say amen? And the minute you hear the sound, he said, move with it. Move with it. I can hear the sound. I've heard it since I've been pastor here. There's times I prophesied if my people would have got one with me and that prophecy, we'd been busting out walls by now. But they're about half here. not H-E-R-E-H-E-A-R, about half hearing and about half paying attention. Because they don't know how to leave all that. Mess outside the church door. They want to bring in everybody's mess and bring in their own mess. Come on, somebody. And then when the Lord speaks, they're so half-minded and half there. Come on now. Ooh, I've told this church, get up and run. Get up and shout. Get up and praise God. My God, after 20 minutes, I still had half the church sitting. You don't want revival till you instantly learn to respond to the Word of God. I like when Janet's ministering, because sometimes the Lord uses her in that dimension to say something now. And boy, I've learned when she says now, I come off of that. See, if I don't do nothing but walk the floor, I'm going to respond to the Word of God. Amen. He said, you go this very day. Don't you halt. Don't you hover. You go this very day. And watch it now. He said, when you go this very day, this same day, into the house of Josiah, the son of Zephaniah, and you watch it now, take silver and gold and make crowns. I know that tell you silver's redemption and gold is a divine nature. Take these, make crowns, and set them on the head of Joshua. Now, wait a minute. Wait just a minute. The priest has got his own headdress. He's supposed to wear a mitre on his head. The crown goes on the king's head. Well, glory, yeah, but the winds of change are blowing. And God is getting ready to do something brand new. And he said, make some crowns of silver and some crowns of gold and go put them on the head of Joshua the high priest. I know that tell you back in Zechariah 4, Joshua took his place standing there as one of those two trees, olive trees, beside the great lampstand of God. And the Lord said, these are my two sons of oil. They're my two witnesses, the king and the priest ministry. Woo! He said, get them on Joshua the son of Joseph, the high priest, and speak unto them. Now God is fixing to set the priest in the throne. Only one ever fulfilled it in totality was David before Jesus. He was a king and a priest. He changed that whole priest order from mourning and sorrow to dancing and shouting. They didn't even play music in the tabernacle. But David raised up the sons of Korah and the sons of Asaph and taught every one of them how to play on instruments. He set the sons of Korah on 15 steps, glory to God, and said, sing on every one of them. Dance on every one of them. He brought public worship. Can you say amen? There's a lie. Worship God in my own way at home. No, you can't worship like you can when the body comes together. There's a certain liberty, a certain freedom takes hold of you. Can you say amen? And he says here, read on, you ain't bored yet, are you? If you are, don't be bored. I'm still excited. But he said, Joshua the son of Josedek, the high priest, puts a crown on him. Speak unto him, saying, thus speaketh the Lord of hosts, saying, behold, the man whose name is the branch. Somebody said, that's Jesus. And then he shall grow up out of his place. Come on now. And he shall build the temple of the Lord. Even he shall build the temple of the Lord, and he shall bear the glory, and glory to God, and shall sit and rule upon his throne. Now that's shouting ground enough till you read the rest of it, and then you'll quit shouting and go to running. Because he says, now listen to this, and he shall be a priest upon his throne. And I want you to listen to this. And the council of peace shall be between.
those.
Hallelujah.
Sound like somebody else is going to sit down in the throne. Come on now. Oh my God. And the crown shall be to Helim and Tobijah and Jediah and him, the son of Zephaniah, for a memorial in the temple of the Lord. And I won't just stop here and tell you the Lord is setting his crown in the temple. We're used to the priesthood in the temple, but we're getting ready to break out in that kingly anointing, that authority, that dominion, that spoken word ministry.
Amen.
And they that are far off shall come and build in the temple of the Lord, and ye shall know that the Lord of hosts has sent me unto you, and this shall come to pass if you will diligently obey the voice of the Lord. My God. Amen. When the Lord goes blowing, shifting, moving, he's setting you up for something big, something powerful. And you better shift with him. In Psalm 78, the Lord said, amen, you don't turn there. We'll never go home if I turn there. The Lord said, he opens his voice and utters parables. And he utters a hidden speech. Is that what it said? And of course, we read the fulfillment of that, didn't we, Sunday, Matthew 13. Without a parable, spake none of it. But then he got talking about generations. He said, this ain't going to be hid from the generation. He started talking about generations to come. He started talking about people that were going to be born. He said, these people ain't even born yet. And he was calling them, telling them, they was a, then the Lord gets, you go all through there and start reading, and God is so mad, literally so angry, and the time you get reading how angry he is, you think either somebody murdered somebody, or they're all committing adultery or something, and you get to reading about it and find out the only thing made him mad was their unbelief. No matter what he done, they never were convinced that they could live in a place where God had fully took them over and taken them out of the realm of needing and wanting and lusting after other things. Hello. And so I was just reading that day. I thought, my God, you'd think he was talking to a gunslinger or something. He wasn't. He was talking to Israel and their unbelief. He eventually said, you people have limited the Holy One of Israel. But then when you go on down, it said, and God was so wroth. And then the next verse said, and he forsook Shiloh. Left it. Changed locations. My God. Moved. And then it said he chose Judah. And Zion, which he loved, for his habitation. Hallelujah. And then in the book of Joshua, when they got ready to move over and pass over, the Bible said they went through the camp and commanded them. Commanded them. I tell you, you don't know how many times I'd like to be anointed to command. I don't know, it just seems like sometimes that sweet milly-milly stuff, people just taking it or leaving. But the Bible said the Lord commanded them to get up from where they were and get ready to move into something else. And he said, when you see, sanctify yourselves today, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you. And he said, when you see the ark go, move after it and keep 2,000 cubits between you and it. And every priest stood in the ground till every man had passed clean over to the other side of the Jordan. Hallelujah. Brother, you're in the chariot of God tonight. The winds of God are blowing in this very hour. And God is going to go into the temple and set a crown on the head of the priesthood. Hallelujah. Amen. And they're going to speak with a new tongue. Amen. And they're going to operate in gifts of the Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Just as sure as I'm standing here, we ain't we ain't nobody gonna bury us. We're not gonna be buried by religion. We're not gonna be snuffed out by dead saints. We're gonna possess the land of promise is ours for the taking. Hallelujah. And we're not gonna be a weak, timid, shy people. We're gonna have a crown. We're gonna have authority. We're gonna have power. And when we speak, everything's going to obey what we say, because we're coming in that authority anointing, that kingly anointing. Glory to God, we're coming into that spoken word. The Lord used old Brother Hall to preach something nobody in this area was preaching at all, called the spoken word ministry. And he decreed it and declared it again and again and again. And he always prophesied that he wouldn't see the day, but that there were those who were sitting under his ministry that had been chosen of God to walk in it. And bless God, we were sitting in that room when he said it. And every time he said it, I would say in my own spirit, yes, and I'm one of them. Hallelujah. That's going to see that day. So the Lord just moved right in there and told all them men, said, don't you let it happen tomorrow. Do it right now, this very day, he said. Glory to God. I hear that in the spirit tonight. This very day, you must believe that these things are yours. Hallelujah. This very day, you must believe that you've been chosen to sit in the throne, and the Lord is going to exalt. Oh, yes, he is. He's going to set up, and he's going to put some things down while he lifts other things up. And them that's put down will be that is in the way, that is trying to hinder, that is trying to stop the work of God from going forth. And God's getting ready to bring forth some big platforms in this kingdom word. And bless God, they ain't going to have to sugar over everything they say so the religious people will partake of it. But they're going to be hungry enough.
Yeah.
And not famine in the land, not for bread or water, but for hearing of the words of the Lord. Glory to God. Amen. Lord, we just thank you tonight for the word and the spirit coming together. Thank you for the king and the priest ministry. Thank you for this great passage of learning tonight to see that when the winds get to work, glory to God. Elamashanda Labosaka. Oh, hallelujah. And the chariots get to turning, and the Lord gets to walking to and fro through this earth. That is because he's setting us up. Oh, yes, setting up his church for the phenomenal, for the outstanding, miraculous, supernatural signs and wonders and gifts of the Holy Ghost. My God, we lay hold on all of it tonight. Lord, we're not going to go through our list and see what we want or don't want. We're going to accept the whole package. We're going to take you at your word. We're going to stand on your promises. For there, yea and amen, glory to God. And we will see the fulfillment of every vision and the fulfillment of every prophetic utterance over us individually and collectively. We will see the fulfillment of all promises made for your good forum tonight. Hallelujah. And we thank you, Lord, that this same Lord is rich unto all them that call on his name tonight. Hallelujah. We praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you tonight. Hallelujah.